Good morning. Happy Monday. Can you hear me in the back? We're good? Okay, welcome to Pepper Canyon Hall 106. Thank you for everybody coming to the new place. I don't think I have enough microphones, so if you have any more microphones to donate to me, I'd be happy to accommodate them. I wasn't happy with the sound quality in the last lecture, so I'm trying a few different ways, and I'll take the best version for the video. So, how many of you had an opportunity to watch the supplement on rubber bands and why they heat up? Okay, some people. I'm going to make that. I was so pleased with myself for how that turned out that I'm going to make that required viewing as homework. It's only going to cost you 6 minutes of your time, but I do want to make that an official part of the course because it really encapsulates everything that we talked about with regard to the distribution of Gaussian trans states and how that affects entropic elasticity and everyday effects, like how if you cool a rubber structure, it actually expands, which is unusual for most solid materials, but it is true for elastomeric materials. So at the end of last class, we talked about different chemical functional groups that are that when you link them up like Legos, give you polymers. So I'm going to give you an example of a famous polymer that's made in this way. So this is called a polycondensation reaction. And we can take something like this. This is called adipoyl chloride. And you can add it to something called hexamethylene diamine or hexane diamine. And when you add these together and you add some a little bit of base in the reaction, you get a famous polymer called nylon 6,6. Six because there are six carbon atoms in each unit. So six carbon atoms in the part that was formerly the adipoyl chloride and six carbon atoms that were formerly in the hexane diamine. And this is nylon 6,6 and it's fishing line. It has very high tensile strength. Usually when you make this, you make it in a biphasic reaction. So you have your organic phase, which this is soluble in, and an aqueous phase where this is soluble, and they polymerize at the interface. And you can draw this material out as it's made, and that's really how fibers of nylon are made. Now this also generates two molecules of HCl as the condensation product. So most condensation reactions give you some small molecule as a byproduct, which is usually has to be removed from the reaction mixture, otherwise the equilibrium could go the other way. And instead of polymerizing, it could hydrolyze and fall apart again. Now, if this were instead of the acid chloride at the group, as the functional groups at the end, but it were a carboxylic acid, like this were C double bond O OH, you could still do this reaction, but it wouldn't be as reactive. And instead of two HCl, you would have two H2Os, because that's the part of this that leaves. that is not part of the final product. Yes?
Does the molecule form a straight chain or like a little circle?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So the question is, does the molecule form a straight chain or does it form a loop? It can form a loop. It can form a loop under very concentrated conditions, but generally what you get is a linear polymer. So this type of polycondensation reaction proceeds by a step growth mechanism. And what I mean by step growth is that any end of any monomer or the reactive ends of any polymer can react with any other polymer or any other monomer in the system, as long as it's an amine reacting with the acid chloride. Now, what does this mean? If you have, what does the molecular weight distribution mean, or what does it look like as a function of consuming these functional groups? Well, if you have a dimer could add to another monomer, or it could add to another dimer. So you could go from 2 to 4 to 8 to 16 to 32, or you could add, you know, an 8-mer to a 2-mer and get 10. It's not a tumor. You could add 8 to a dimer and get 10, and then the molecular weight distribution adds like that. So any polymer can add to any other polymer, and as a result, at the beginning of the reaction, you have relatively low molecular weight, and then as the polymer chains add up and you start getting really huge molecular weights, then the average molecular weight goes up, kind of like a hockey stick. Yeah.
A little bit of OCAM territory here, but a mechanism question. So each mer attaches because we see the chlorine end of an adipoil react with the amine end, right? So if we just saw a single molecule each of adipoyl chloride and hexane diamine react with each other, wouldn't we still see ends that are one size of chlorine, one size of amine?
Yes, so you would always end with, so I wrote parentheses here because this is just the repeat unit, but at the end of any given chain, you know, it doesn't go on forever, and at the end of any given chain, there's going to be a free amine or a free acid chloride. Yeah.
Unless it forms the loop. Right?
Unless it forms a loop, yeah. But we're not going to form, generally not going to form loops in this class. But in general, they react because the amine, because of its lone pair, is electron rich. And the acid chloride, because it's attached, this carbon atom is the reactive carbon atom, it's electron poor. So it's really just Coulomb's law. I mean, there's some quantum mechanics and stuff in there, but it's really just positive and negative attracting to each other and kicking out the HCl after the reaction. So as a result of this growth profile that looks kind of like a hockey stick, you can take the average molecular weight of a given polymer chain in the sample, and if you plot that as a function of percent conversion of end groups, you get some profile that looks like that. Does that make sense? It's a little bit, because you're adding dimers to tetramers to so on, and at the very end you get large molecular weights. It's a little bit like having a penny and doubling it every day for a month, and at the end of the month you'll have $1 million. But on the 15th, tax day, you'll be poor still. So here's tax day. Here's the end of the month. Now, you can imagine other types of polymerization reactions. For example, what if instead of a free-for-all, which is what we have here, where any chain end can react with any other chain end or monomer, what if only the growing chain end was reactive and only toward other monomers? In that case, instead of getting these steps, this step growth mechanism, we would have something which is a chain growth mechanism where the chain gets larger by adding one monomer after another. So we have step growth. Versus chain growth. But chain growth has two different flavors. So you can have in a reaction, you can have chains just start polymerizing and go really fast and then stop, like they're running into a brick wall. So it goes from a monomer, dimer, trimer, you know, four-mer, five-mer, six-mer, and then it stops for some reason, like the reactive end gets quenched by some impurity or it reacts with some other monomer or some other growing chain end in the system. But everything else in the whole reaction vessel is still a monomer. And then it happens somewhere else, just zoop, 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 zoop. How's that go again? Zoop. One more time for emphasis. Zoop. And that is also uncontrolled. So that's an uncontrolled chain growth. I call that the popcorn mechanism. Because when you have an air popper or a microwave, the kernels pop kind of randomly. What if instead of that, all the popcorn kernels got bigger slowly at the same time? That would be another type of, that would give you a different reaction profile. And that's called a controlled or living polymerization mechanism. And I liken that to instead of how popcorn is made, it's how grass grows. So this is like the grass mechanism. Step growth and uncontrolled chain growth both give us a reaction profile that look like this. What would a controlled or living grass-like process give us? It would be more like this. Because they're all growing at the same time and they have pretty much the same molecular weight as a function of the percent of the end groups that have reacted at any given time. Yeah. Yes, but I don't. So an example of a controlled chain growth would be an amino acid polymerizing in biochemistry, but I don't want to mention that yet because the reaction proceeds by polycondensation, which is usually associated with step growth. So that's an exception that I don't want to get into. Yeah.
So you're saying that the chain growth is for uncontrolled. Is that still like more logarithmic, or is that one also? For the popcorn mechanism, would that also be like more linear, or is it more like popcorn?
No, it's more like the step growth. So the uncontrolled, I actually did an Excel spreadsheet over, because, you know, what do I have to do on Sunday other than spreadsheets? And I tried to make some visuals and they didn't come out so good. So I'll just use chalk instead. But there is, in uncontrolled chain growth and step growth, You definitely have more of this exponential profile. I really do want to get going, but what is the question?
We have polycondensation for step growth, so our uncontrolled chain growth is usually homogeneous, like single monomer, or can it be multiple?
You can have multiple kinds of monomers in a step growth. In a controlled chain, you also can have multiple kinds of monomers. And that's actually a big area of research, is making polymers that have different functionalities, like instead of AAA the whole way, it's A, B, C, A, B, D, F, X, Y. Okay, so let's leave these chemical structures for a little bit.
Yay.
and we'll abstract them as A's and B's and derive something called the Carothers equation, which tells us what our average degree of polymerization is going to be as a function of the extent of the reaction. So this is all step growth. We're gonna do chain growth in a couple days, but we're gonna stick to step growth for now. I just want you to know that we will arrive at these other mechanisms soon. So imagine we have this, which is, imagine this is like a Lego piece that has a concave side and a convex side. This is AB. And when you polymerize this, you get something like this. So far, so good. Now, what do I mean by convex and concave? This could be, for example, something like an amino acid. And when we polymerize it, we could get something that looks like this polyamide. Notice that this monomer system is a little bit different from the monomer system that we were talking about before. Namely, this has one functional group on either side of the molecule, whereas before we had the same functional group on each side, and it was reacting with something else that had the same functional group on each side. It pretty much works the same way, except that this is reacting with another molecule of itself as opposed to another molecule of something else, as a molecule of something else. So similarly, we could have something that was like a pill, like an AA monomer plus a BB monomer to give us something like this. That makes sense? And this could be like a diacid plus a diamine where R1 and R2 are just some hydrocarbon, some CH2, 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 or it could be anything. Could be a benzene ring, could be anything. And then when you add these two together, you get something that's sort of superficially similar to what we had over there, except that it's derived from two different monomers with the opposite functional groups. This is also a polyamide. This we would call a diacid, and this would be a diamine. To get this reaction to go, you would need a catalyst, or you would need really high heat and pressure in order to drive off the water, which of course is the worst N ever. You would need to drive off the water in order to drive this reaction to the right. Usually it would be done with a catalyst. And in fact, it would probably usually be done with the acid chloride, not the acid, because it's more reactive. But this is the general idea. What we're going to do in this analysis is assume that all the functional groups are equally reactive. So we're going to assume that all the functional groups are equally reactive. So far, so good. And we're going to define a quantity little x sub n, which is the number average chain length. Or the number average degree of polymerization. So monomer, a bunch of monomers is one, half dimers or half monomers and half dimers, x sub n would be 1.5 because it's just the average degree of polymerization or the average chain length in units of monomers of what's in the pot. So we're going to imagine 16 monomers, and this implies 32 functional groups. Because each monomer can react on one side or the other side, so two functional groups per monomer. And we'll draw them in a grid. One more set. Of course, molecules don't really exist in a grid. They're moving all over the place. And you have many more than 16 of them. But the math is the same. OK, so you go from a scenario where you have all monomers. And then what we're going to do is react 25% of the functional groups in the in the pot. So let's say that these react and form a dimer, these react and form a dimer, these react and form a dimer, these react and form a dimer. You now have x sub n equals 8 molecules times a length of 1 plus 4 molecules times a length of 2 divided by the total number of molecules in the pot, which is now 12. It's no longer 16, it's now 12 because 4 of them are dimers. And this gives you 1.3 for 25% reaction. So 25% of the reactive groups have reacted, and we have an average degree of polymerization of 1.3. So far, so good. Now let's increase it to 50% reaction. So let's say this became a trimer. This is still a dimer, but these two merged, and this one added this guy to become a trimer. So now we have, by this same arithmetic, we now have x sub n equals 2 at 50% reaction. Are we a little surprised that we've consumed half of the reactivity in the pot, but we now only have a pot full of an average of dimers? Kind of crazy, right? I mean, we used up half the reactivity and we still only have just dimers. What if we increase that to 75% reaction? And now we have, say, this polymer and this one reacted all the way down here, and we still have this. One piece of chalk costs 75 cents. And X sub n is 4. I get them imported from Japan. Seriously. 4 microphones, chalk imported from Japan. I love you guys. This is now 75% reaction, and our average degree of polymerization is only 4. I'm not going to draw this out again, but even to achieve x sub n equals 8, we have to react 87.5% of the functional groups. So this is still a very low degree of polymerization. This is barely even a polymer. We might call this an oligomer because it's so short. But we've consumed so many of the reactive groups. So for high molecular weight, so this is still very low. So for high molecular weight, the reaction must go toward completion. So like greater than 99% reaction. And there's a general formula for coming up with your average degree of polymerization based on the percent reaction. And this was an insight attributed to Carothers, a very famous dude in the annals of polymer science. So this is how we get the Carothers equation, and we're going to define n sub 0 as the number of monomers originally present in the system. And n without the subscript is the number of molecules. So this is monomers plus any of the molecules that have been formed at a given time. Yep?
How are you getting a 75% reaction? What criteria are you basing it on?
So we have 32 functional groups here that are available to be reacted. And then over here, how many do we have left? We have 2 from this one, 1 from this because it's only reacted on one side, 1 from this, 1 from this, 1 from this, and 1 from this, and 1 from this. So that should be 8.
Oh, it's 8 out of 16.
8 out of 32.
Oh, yeah.
So that's the number unreacted. So 24 is 75%. Yep.
Why does it matter that it's high molecular weight for? Yeah.
Oh, why do we care if it's high molecular weight? If it's low molecular weight, we basically have a waxy solid or a liquid that has a low melting temperature, low tensile strength. We get no engineering properties out of it. Yeah, that's a really good point. You know, I have the value system that high molecular weight is good, but maybe you don't have that yet. High molecular weight is good. If it's too high, though, it becomes insoluble or unprocessable in a factory. Yeah, good point. So n without the 0 is the number of molecules present in the system at any time. say, any time t. We're not going to use t yet today, but we will soon. So the difference between n sub 0 and n is actually the total number of functional groups of either A or B that have reacted at time t. Okay, we're going to define another variable called lowercase p, which is the extent of reaction. Which equals the difference in the number of in the total number of monomers present initially in the system minus the number of molecules at any time t divided by the original number of monomers in the system. And if we solve for n, we get n naught times 1 minus p. And since x sub n equals the total number of monomers present in the system at time 0, and they didn't go anywhere, so they're all still there. Some of them are incorporated into new molecules. If we divide this by the number of molecules present in the system at any time, that is the average, the number average number of monomers in each molecule in the system. So we can combine these terms to give us x sub n equals 1 over 1 minus p. Very simple expression. This is the Carothers equation, named after Professor Equation. I can use that joke once per quarter, but that's it. So this has some serious consequences. Let's make a table. It's a table with only two entries. For an extent of reaction of 95%, x sub n equals 50. Average degree of polymerization of 50. How about 99%? Average degree of polymerization is still only 100. Now, 100 seems like a lot. I'd like to have $100 right now. But consider the fact that a milk jug, a high molecular weight polyethylene, probably has 10,000, an average degree of polymerization of like 10,000. So we need to, we really need very high extensive polymerization in order to achieve high molecular weight. So for example, for good fibers of nylon 6/6, say for fishing line, or anything else that's nylon, zip ties. To have good, I'll get to your question in just a second. To have good molecular weight, say an M sub N of 12 kilodaltons, where Dalton is just a gram per mole. We need X sub N of around 110. So P must be greater than 0.99%. So in order for nylon 6,6, which is intrinsically a strong polymer because it actually has, you know, there are 14 atoms in the backbone, and it has lots of hydrogen bonding with the C double bond O's and the NH groups. Lots of reasons why it has high tensile strength. We still need to get quite high degrees of polymerization. Yeah.
When P is 0.95, is X N 20?
I don't. Good point. 3 years, first person to see that. Actually proves my point even better. Okay, how do we control the molecular weight? If it is too low, we have poor properties. If it's too high, it's difficult to process. And by process, I mean either melt or solubilize. So for example, since we're talking about nylon, there's the nylon rope trick, where you have a beaker and you have two layers that don't want to mix. This is the organic phase. Let's say it's some organic phase that has a density greater than the density of water. And this is the aqueous phase. And the organic phase contains the adipoyl chloride. And I drew the structure at the beginning of class. And the aqueous phase has the hexane diamine. Now, if we dissolve these together, they would just form a solid block and you couldn't do anything with it. But as it is, if you take advantage of the fact that this is an interfacial polymerization, you can take a hook that you just say, fashion out of wire. And you can draw this material up into this hook, and you can make basically fishing line directly from this process. So another thing you can do is control the heat and the pressure. So high heat and low pressure will drive off the condensation products. So if water is formed during the condensation, you'll drive it off, and you'll, by Le Chatelier's principle, shift the equilibrium toward the polymer side. But if you reduce the heat or reduce the pressure, then you'll have lower molecular weight stuff. This is called glycerol. And this is called sebaceic acid. And this is one of the principal waxy components that forms on your skin from the sebaceous gland secretions. Fascinating. Largely, the goal of a shower is to get rid of this, or at least the feeling of cleanliness arises from having gotten rid of it. And when you polymerize this, you get polyglycerol co-sebacate, or PGS, which is a biodegradable elastomer. So it's a stretchy material that's used in, for example, tissue engineering applications because it dissolves or it hydrolyzes under physiological conditions into things that aren't really that harmful. Yep.
So what makes things biodegradable?
For biodegradability, you need ester linkages like this. And what's implied but not necessary for biodegradability is lack of toxicity of the byproducts. So, I mean, you can have toxic byproducts, but then why would anyone want it in a surgical implant? So ester groups are good at biodegrading. That's by far the most common one. You can also make degradable polymers that are degradable with enzymes, for example, that break specific bonds. Okay, yep.
Is the reason why styrofoam can't be dissolved because of high molecular weight?
So the reason styrofoam can be dissolved in organic solvents like acetone and stuff, but it can't be hydrolyzed like in the body or in I think what you mean is, why can't it be biodegraded in the outdoor environment or like in a biological system? And the reason is because its backbone is a pure carbon chain, and there's no place for the water to get in and break apart the chain. So we'll talk about styrene, polystyrene, and styrofoam more when we talk about chain growth polymerizations. So it's actually made in a different type of mechanism than this, and it gives you different reactive properties in the backbone. So the last thing that I want to mention takes advantage of the fact that the Carothers equation is very sensitive to the extent of reaction, P. So this is control by a stoichiometric imbalance. So that is an excess of one reactant in an AA/BB system limits the molecular weight. So what you have in the case of, and the reason for this is makes sense if you think about it. Like if you have an excess of the BBs, even just like a 1% excess of the BBs, then pretty soon all the chain ends are going to end in B. And the Bs can't react with B, they can only react with A. So as soon as there's a slight excess, then you prevent those chains from growing any further. And that can be quantified through a modified Carothers equation, which takes into account the stoichiometric imbalance through this parameter lowercase r. So it's x sub n equals 1 plus r over 1 plus r minus 2 rp, where r is the stoichiometric imbalance, n sub 0 of AA, so the number of monomers of AA originally present, and the number of monomers of BB originally present. And this gives you this is equivalent to the number of unreacted functional groups. And to do this calculation properly, the excess goes in the denominator. So that R is always less than 1. So in the last 60 seconds of class, for a quantitative reaction, where quantitative means that P is greater than or equal to 0.999, which ordinarily, under the Carothers equation, with exactly the same number of AAs and BBs together, it would give you fairly high degrees of polymerization. But if you instead have a stoichiometric imbalance, suppose you have a stoichiometric balance, so R is 1, X sub n equals 1,000. But instead, what if you have a 5% excess of the B monomer? Then you have R equals 0.952, and X sub n, ready for this, is just 39. So if we have a little bit of impurity in one of our starting materials and we put it into the reaction mixture, that causes us to mismeasure one of the components, then we have reduced the average degree of polymerization by 96% by only a 5% error. Conversely, if we want to have lower molecular weight, we can do this on purpose. That's where we'll end today. Thanks for your attention.